beautiful Thursday morning. You're listening to Bhavani at iEat Green on the Progressive Radio Network. And this morning it feels like winter has arrived. I am just not ready for this. It's freezing cold, and I have a lot of schlepping to start doing today. Today's my big day to start gathering all of my food and supplies for this big weekend, which is my Thanksgiving feast for the homeless. I start my cooking on Saturday. I just looked. I have over 128 people, or 128 people signed up so far to come every 3 hours, 16 at a time on 3-hour shifts. And we will cook starting Saturday all the way through till Tuesday when we serve everybody in Rufus King Park. And we make enough food for over 1,000 people. And donations come from everywhere. And this has been going on now. This is my 24th year. And I'm really excited to be doing it again this year. Although it just comes so fast, and I wish Thanksgiving and Christmas were a little further apart, because I do this again for Christmas, and it's just not enough recovery time in between. So I wish I could spread it out, but alas, I have no control of the calendar, so we will be doing it again Christmas time. So I am putting a call out to anyone listening. If you have coats to donate, we do a huge coat drive during this feeding of the homeless. I think some people come more for the coats than they do for the food. You know, many of these people, they're not actually homeless. Many of them are just living in, you know, run-down tenement buildings with inadequate heat, and they just need to keep warm. We also collect sleeping bags. I heard a really sad story of this one girl saying she wanted a sleeping bag, not a blanket, because then no old man can climb in with her in the middle of the night and try to molest her. So anyway, we're also collecting sleeping bags, coats, hats, gloves, anything to help people stay warm during these cold winter months. Check out the sign-up on ieatgreen.com. There's still a few spaces, I think Sunday evening and Monday evening and Tuesday early morning, if you want to volunteer. So I am really excited. Today I have a friend, colleague on as my guest, Donna Casali. She is executive director and founding member of the B Corporation called Beautycounter. And they are bringing safer beauty products to the public, and she will talk to us about all the toxins that are in personal care items that we have no idea about, and ways to avoid them. So she'll be coming on in a little bit, but first I want to talk to you a little about some of the things that I wrote about this week in my blog. The most important thing is organic foods. As a big promoter of organic foods, it's really important to me that the regulations that we have set up are regulations that we can count on and feel confident with. And over the last few years, we've been hearing more and more about the infiltration of big agribusiness into the National Organic Standards Board, or the National Organic Program. And we really need to do something about it. And there is a organization that has started up called the Real Organic Project, which really is trying to look at this problem and look at making another label that would be above organic so we can really feel more confident about the labeling. Cornucopia Institute has great guides about organic, and so does the Environmental Working Group. Those are great resources to check out. Also, when we get to the personal care products later on in the show, the Environmental Working Group rates those as well, especially when it comes to things like sunscreen. So those are websites you really want to know about, EWG.org and CornucopiaInstitute.org. But really important. And so, you know, what's been happening is because they have weakened the standards, especially when it comes to organic dairy and eggs, we have this vision of, you know, chickens roaming freely out on the pasture, but that's really not what's happening. They might be cage-free, but they still barely have room to turn around. And those have been being approved as organic eggs. So they're still standing in, you know, dirty feces and, you know, still getting their, you know, beaks cut so they won't peck at each other and, you know, some horrible animal welfare issues as well. So you really want to check out these websites and really find out which eggs are really organic, which dairy is really organic. And the other sad thing is that they're really putting a lot of these organic dairy farmers out of business because they can't compete price-wise. If you're really doing it the right way and upholding the organic standards, you can't compete with those that still have, you know, thousands of cows that they're saying are organic still being hooked up to machines and not getting out to pasture. So, you know, check out the article that I wrote on my blog this week. Sign up, you know, support the Real Organic Project. And you can actually even send suggestions to the Organic Standards Board or the National Organic Standards Board and let your voices be heard. So, as you know, after this election, it's just more important than ever that we all take a role and become active citizens and let our voices be heard. You know, I have to also put a big shout out to California. I'm sure you all heard about Proposition 12, the first time that animal welfare really is being taken into consideration. They passed a historic law giving animals better conditions on farms. And it's really, you know, it's still not perfect. I mean, you know, they're now talking about, you know, each chicken having a full square foot as if that's, you know, really wonderful. But it's certainly better than how it was. I think they say beginning in 2020, the law will require that veal sold in the state comes only from calves who have more than 43 square feet of space. And hens, including chickens, turkeys, ducks, geese, and fowl will have at least 1 square foot. And that's in 2020. And they're shouting that out is such a wonderful thing. 1 square foot per chicken. Not a lot. So, and these are this is the historic, wonderful animal welfare rule. So it still has a lot to be desired, but it's certainly better than what's going on right now. So, congratulations, California, and hopefully other states will follow in suit. And I want to also share with you my weekly recipe. Because Thanksgiving is around the corner, everyone always asks me for this stuffed heirloom pumpkin recipe. So once again, I'm going to share my stuffed pumpkin recipe. It's one of those recipes, you know, when people pull out a turkey from the oven and everybody looks at it and goes, ooh, you know, it's so beautiful. You know, and they see this golden roasted turkey and it's like a centerpiece. This stuffed pumpkin is actually so much more beautiful. So, you know, find a really beautiful pumpkin that you can stuff. It can be an orange pumpkin like you might carve for Halloween, or it could be an heirloom pumpkin like the Long Island cheese pumpkin, which I grow here. Whichever one it is, try to find one that is organic if possible, or by, you know, at least grown by a farmer that you know. You want to cut a hole in the top, basically take off the lid, and you're going to scoop out the inside and remove all the seeds. And of course you can save the seeds and roast them if you'd like. They're always delicious. Kids love them. With a little salt and just a little oil, makes them extra delicious. But anyway, so you want to start with a large pumpkin that you're going to roast. If you have a large table and you want to go with a little bit of smaller pumpkin, you can actually consider having two little bit smaller pumpkins, you know, at one end of the table, each at one end of the table, and you're going to be serving right out of the pumpkin, so it's great. It keeps you down on one cleaning item. So also, you want 1.5 pounds of seitan. You can use homemade seitan or store-bought, or if you are on a gluten-free diet, of course, you can substitute tofu or tempeh for that. Or you can even substitute a can of beans, whatever you'd like. 1 onion chopped, 4 carrots cut into wedges. And I like, instead of just cutting them into rounds, you know, I do the macrobiotic cut where I usually peel the carrot first just because it makes the carrot brighter colored and looks prettier. And then I roll the carrot and I do a cut on an angle and roll the carrot halfway each time I cut so that each wedge has a lot of different facets to it. And they really look prettier and they're perfect bite size that way. 1 pound of mushrooms sliced. I use shiitake and portobellos. 2 yellow squash, 1 butternut squash, 1 sweet potato cut into chunks, 2 red or yellow peppers, 1 head of broccoli cut into florets, 4 parsnips, 1/2 a small napa cabbage, 2 baby bok choys, a quarter cup of tamari, 4 cloves of garlic, a 2-inch piece of ginger grated, 2 tablespoons of aji marin. That's sweet rice wine. And be careful when you buy sweet rice wine that it actually is a rice wine. I know Kikkoman sells a brand of aji marin that if you look at it, it's just glucose syrup, pure sugar syrup. It is not aji marin, and it actually upsets me a lot that Whole Foods carries that. So Eden brand is a really good one, and I'm sure at an Asian market you can also find other brands that really contain sweet rice wine. 2 tablespoons of tahini mixed with 1 cup of water, 1 package of frozen peas. I use frozen organic baby peas. 1 pound of potatoes cut into chunks, 2 sprigs of rosemary, and 2 sprigs of thyme. And so you've already cut the circle out into the top of the pumpkin and scraped out the seeds. And you want to bake the pumpkin in an oven, a low oven for a long time. So like a 300-degree oven for about an hour and a half, two hours. Again, it depends on the size of the pumpkin. But cover the pumpkin with some tin foil. Make a tent over it and put some tin foil over it so that the top of the pumpkin doesn't burn. And it's also possible that, depending on the size of your oven, sometimes the top piece that you've cut out, if it has a bit of a stem, doesn't fit either. So you can just turn that upside down and bake it that way so that the stem is actually inside the cavity of the pumpkin. And while that's roasting, you're going to start by sauteing the onions, carrots, butternut squash, parsnips, and potatoes and sweet potatoes in a large stock pot with just a little bit of olive oil. You can add the garlic and the ginger to this and cook it for about 10 minutes on low, stirring it frequently so that it's not sticking to the bottom of the pan. If it starts to stick, you can add a little bit of water just to help steam it and move it along and deglaze the pan of anything that's stuck to the bottom. Then you're going to add the broccoli, the mushrooms, the peppers, the yellow squash, the bok choy, the cabbage, and the herbs, and any other veggies you want. And, you know, I always tell people when you're the chef, you can put in what you love and leave out what you don't love. You can also use up what you have in the fridge that needs to be used up. It's really up to you. So the vegetables that are in this dish are really flexible. And if you're going to use beans, chickpeas are really great here. Black beans are good. Northern white beans are great, good. So whatever you'd like. Then you're going to add the tahini that's mixed with the water, along with the mirin, the tamari, and the frozen peas. At that point, you can add the seitan. Just let the whole pot cook and come together like a stew in the pot for about 20 minutes. And when the pumpkin's soft, you're going to pull out the pumpkin and you're going to put all of that stuffing into the vegetable stew into the pumpkin and return it to the oven for about 30 more minutes. Now, if you want to do this in parts or do some of it ahead of time, you can, of course, roast the pumpkin a couple days ahead of time as long as you have room in the refrigerator to keep it cold, or if it's cold enough like now, you can put it outside, but you don't want to let it freeze. And you can make the stew also a couple days ahead of time. Just know if you heat the stew up first before putting it into the pumpkin, it will help heat the pumpkin up quicker. If you put the stew in cold from the refrigerator, it's going to take a long time for that to get warm in the middle. So I would recommend heating the stew up first before you add it to the pumpkin, and you might even put the pumpkin in the oven and let that start getting warm. But it's a great thing because you can do it a little bit ahead of time and make that day of Thanksgiving a little bit easier. So enjoy, and now it is my pleasure to introduce to all of you my guest today. Donna Casali is the executive director and founding member of Beautycounter, which is a B-Corp, whose mission is to get safer products into the hands of everyone. And she describes herself as a health and wellness educator and advocate whose focus is what you put on your largest organ, which, of course, is your skin. She says most people don't realize that many ingredients that are banned in other countries like Canada and the EU are actually allowed in personal care products here in our country. And these questionable ingredients, as many of you know, are carcinogenic and are hormone disruptors, and they can impact our overall health, fertility, and lead to reproductive and developmental issues. And Donna's really advocated for this. She's attended meetings both locally and in Washington, D.C., lobbying for better safety standards in personal care products, and I'm really excited to have her join us today and talk about the things that we need to avoid in our personal care products. So welcome, Donna.
Thank you for having me, Bhavani. I'm so excited to be here today.
Great. So why don't you tell me a little bit first, a little bit about your history. How did you come to even know that personal care products was something you wanted to find out more about, or that there were toxins in there? And then how did you come to find Beautycounter?
So the truth is that I didn't know what I didn't know. I was someone who for probably 25 years was using green cleaners in her home, because I have a husband who's very sensitive to fragrance, so that was on my radar. I was very much into eating clean and, you know, looking at ingredients in food, so that was something that I loved to talk about with friends. That was on my radar, but this really wasn't. And the way it came on my radar was that a friend of mine out on the West Coast in California recently got involved with Beautycounter, and she posted something on Facebook. It was a video that basically, it was this black and white dramatic video, and it said, do you know what's in your products? And then it was listing, like, all of the ingredients, and people were trying to pronounce them, and then it told you what they were and, you know, how they were hormone disruptors or carcinogens. And did you know that the last time the United States passed a major federal law was 1938? Or actually, it asked the question, when was the last time a major federal law was passed? And people were guessing, you know, the 70s, you know, and when we found out at the end, you know, in the middle of this video that it was 1938, it kind of really hit me that, wow, there's so much that I don't know. And so I just kind of decided to get involved, because I felt like if I was someone that didn't know this and I knew a lot about food and a lot about household cleaners, then, you know, what does everybody else know about this? Probably not a whole lot either. So I saw it as this amazing opportunity to educate people, to put this on their radar, because for me, I'm all about health and wellness, and health is your most important asset. So if this is the missing piece, then people need to know how they can make better, safer choices.
Uh-huh. And what are some of the toxins that immediately come to your mind that are in everything? You know, I talk to my listeners a lot about sunscreen, mm-hmm. because that's, you know, I know that our skin is our largest organ, and I watch parents all the time in a loving gesture to try to protect their children from the sun, mm-hmm. lather all this Coppertone and mm-hmm. other brands that are mm-hmm. so toxic all over their children, and I'm in the back of my head, you know, I'm thinking what I know, but I don't want to say anything because, you know the mother's coming from a good place trying to do the right thing to their child. You know, so what are some of those really horrible toxins?
So I think that, you know, there are certain product categories that are more inherently toxic. Like you mentioned, sunscreen is one of them. But if you actually look on the label, the things that you want to look for would be in sunscreen, there are two things. It's the oxybenzone. And that's the ingredient that now is in the news, that it's harming the coral reefs. But it's funny, Bhavani, because I've been trying to talk to people for the last 5 years about sunscreen. And people care about, you know, do we test on animals? Of course not. We don't test on animals. But when people ask me that question, I invariably say, guess what? We're the animals that are being tested on, because most of these ingredients in our products have never been tested for human health. So oxybenzone is something that is known as a hormone disruptor. We know that it's killing the coral reefs. Thank goodness it's finally in the news. So people now, because they care so much about animals and the environment and wildlife, now it's on their radar. So now they'll talk to me about sunscreen, and they're open to swapping out their sunscreen. So I'm happy about that. But so it's the oxybenzone and the retinol palmitate, which is another ingredient. That's a derivative of vitamin A, and what that does is it basically promotes cellular turnover. So, like, if you're someone that has had things removed from your skin, lesions that were suspicious, you definitely don't want to be using retinol palmitate in your sunscreen, because that is going to kind of promote the growth of tumors. So that would be...
Wow.
Yeah.
So Beautycounter is a company that you say is a B Corp, which maybe you can tell people a little bit what a B Corp is, but then also what makes their products better than what's the average products that are on the market.
So So a B Corp is, that's short for benefit corporation. So two that you might be familiar with offhand would be Ben & Jerry's and Patagonia. To be a B Corp, you have to go through a certification and you have to show that you are solving a social problem and that you have something called a triple bottom line. So it's not just about the profits, it's also about the planet and it's about people. So it's really written into the constitution, if you will, of the company that they're doing things that are environmentally sound, that they have a policy in place for their employees that to have fair practices, that they're, you know, specifically the problem we're solving at Beautycounter is we are making products safer and we're educating people about what's in their products and we're advocating for more health protective laws. So we're very proud of that, B Corporation, and actually our number even is getting higher and higher. You get like a rating. I don't know offhand what the number is. But really it's using business as a force for good. That's kind of the tagline of what a B Corporation is. So we're very, very proud. And I think the thing that really is cool about Beautycounter is we're showing that you could be pro-commerce, but you can also be pro-regulation. So what does that mean? Most companies don't want to regulate the industry they're in, right? They don't want the government to tell them what to do necessarily. But we welcome the regulation. We want it because it makes our job easier to bring safer products into the marketplace if we know that our suppliers are beholden to more health protective laws, right? That the raw materials, which, by the way, we test, you know, so many different ways, but we would love more regulation. We would love this company to say things like oxybenzone should not be used. And so that's kind of, you know, what Beautycounter is doing at this point, advocating, educating, and then creating a safer solution through product.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny hearing you talk about your company doing all this testing, because one of my pet peeves is that our government relies on the industry to do their own testing because our government has no money for testing for safety products. So the Food and Drug Administration, who should be testing for all the chemicals that are being put on our, mm-hmm. our into our foods, they don't test for it. They allow the chemical companies to do the testing and tell us that it's safe. So, you know, so I'm always skeptical and wary of the company themselves doing the testing, but you're actually doing it in reverse in that you're doing the testing but looking for the regulation and looking to prove that your product doesn't have that in it.
Yes, 100%. You know, I think of the cosmetics industry, it's a little bit like the Wild West, the lack of regulation. And the fact that it is a self-governing body, that they're the ones that are determining what's safe and what's not safe. And by the way, what they're looking at are things like, is it going to burn your skin? Is it going to burn your eyes? They're not doing this extensive health testing where they're looking up, you know, at hormone disruption or is it a carcinogen? I mean, yes, there are at this point 30 ingredients that are banned. But when you compare that with about 600 in Canada and close to 1,400 in the EU, you know, there are so many, there are hundreds of ingredients that we're using in this country that are banned in other countries. And because they're linked to cancer and because they're suspected or known to be endocrine disruptors. So it's just really kind of mind-blowing that you know, this is the state of affairs.
Yeah, well, our country's like that. I mean, we allow almost anything into our products, and then it's up to the consumer to push to try to do testing, to try to prove that it's bad, to then try to get it out of our products, as opposed to testing first to make sure it's safe before putting it into the products. And that's the same with genetically modified ingredients. I mean, the EU didn't allow them at all. And now they allow them with labeling, and they only allow them because countries like our country kind of railroad them into having to accept them or, you know, threat of, you know, retaliation and stuff. So they do allow it, but they require labeling. And we actually have a family member that works for Nestle, and he says, you know, all the products that Nestle makes for our country that contain genetically modified ingredients, they make for the European market without any of those ingredients. They even can't put genetically modified ingredients in the dog food in Europe. And, you know, so it cracks me up. It's like the dogs are eating healthier food in Europe than the majority of Americans here in this country.
Well, see, this is the thing that I think is really upsetting. When you think about multinational companies that are producing, whether it's food or personal care products in both the U.S. and the European Union, There are two different recipes, if you will, for the products that are manufactured and sold here versus in the EU. And just as you were saying, the ingredients that are banned there, they have to work around that, right? So they know how to make these products without those ingredients. But why are they using them here? Do you have any idea why? Well, it's cheaper.
Business.
Yeah. It's the bottom line. It's the dollar. And that's, you know, so we're getting the short end of the stick by that.
But it's not like we pay less for the product. We pay the same amount, so it's just more money in the pocket of the corporation.
Right. So the thing about Beautycounter is we're using the precautionary principle. We're saying things are guilty until proven innocent, right? Whereas this country, it's kind of like, you know, after World War II, the whole better living through chemistry, when plastics came on the market, and everybody thought, ooh, plastics, they're great. Now, what do we know about plastics? You know, we know that they're hormone disruptors, right? The BPA and the BPS. They're, you know, we didn't know when all of that first came out. But I think this is the opportunity right now. When you look back and you see that, like when you and I were growing up, Bhavani, we didn't have seatbelts in the cars, and there was lead in the gasoline, and there was lead in the paint. And we look back at that now, and we say, we can't believe that we were walking around, we were living with smoking on planes and smoking in restaurants and all these things. So, but now we look back and we say, okay, we made these laws to protect our health. So this is now what we need to do in this industry. And I really believe that years from now, and I hope it's not too far in the near future, we're going to look back and say, I can't believe that we were using sunscreen with all of these ingredients and that we didn't know what we didn't know. So that's my hope for this. That's an analogy I'd like to make.
And what about fragrance? How do they get fragrance into products? And are the fragrances also toxic, or are they natural, herbal?
Yeah.
Well, so smells.
Fragrance is probably probably is the biggest loophole that is allowed right now. And it really dates back to proprietary, you know, trade secrets. So back, you know, in the days of Chanel No. 5 and all of the perfume manufacturers, they didn't want the other companies stealing their trade secrets. So they were allowed to use this labeling loophole where they didn't have to disclose what the individual fragrance components are. So when you see fragrance, the word fragrance or parfum on a label, it could be really, it usually is a at least, you know, a dozen or could be hundreds of ingredients under that one ingredient of fragrance. And typically, what makes fragrance stick to your skin is a class of chemicals called phthalates. And phthalates are known hormone disruptors. So I like to tell people fragrance is the new secondhand smoke. So what does that mean? So it's not just breathing the fragrance in, but, you know, if you hug someone or your child has spent time with an aunt or a grandma who wears a lot of perfume, and then they come home smelling like that person, it's very transferable through skin, and we're absorbing all of these endocrine-disrupting ingredients that now can really mess with our hormones. And hormones regulate everything from your weight to your fertility to your overall health. And certain breast cancers are estrogen-driven. So that's the thing about really kind of not staying away from fragrance. And I don't mean just like perfume and cologne. I mean, fragrance is an ingredient in every personal care product on the market. Very few of them, you know, won't use that labeling loophole. So really what you want is to look at, that's like the first thing that you want to avoid on a label is that word fragrance or parfum. You want to use products that are scented with essential oils and that list those oils out on the label, because you just don't know what you're getting. You could be getting all of these industrial chemicals in your face cream or your hand wash, you know.
So. And, first comes to my mind is laundry soap, right? Laundry soap and what's the stuff that makes it, that you put in to make it soft and not static?
You know? They're like the dry
sheets? Fabric softener. Or fabric sheets, right. Those things that are so smelly. I mean,
yeah,
you know, people.
So smelly.
You know, you hug somebody or, you know, their clothes, you know, in their closet. Well, just you open their closet and it smells like that fabric softener.
And by the way, you're absorbing, if your clothes have been washed with the smelly laundry detergent and the dryer sheet, you're absorbing that through your skin when you wear those clothes.
Right.
The thing about the household products is you can buy fragrance-free. Fragrance-free is an option. Fragrance-free isn't always an option when you're talking about personal care products. And typically, they're using fragrance to mask some of the other chemicals that are necessary to preserve products. It's not that Beautycounter doesn't use chemicals. You know, not all chemicals are bad. It doesn't, safety doesn't have to do with the source of something, whether it's an organic, you know, natural occurring product in the earth versus synthetic. You can have safe synthetics and you can have very toxic, quote-unquote, organic products. Like, let's talk about heavy metals for a minute.
Or arsenic.
Yeah. Heavy metals occur naturally in the soil, and they're used in colorants for a lot of makeup, even mineral makeup. So people think, oh, I'm using a mineral makeup, it must be safer, it must be better. But wait a minute. Is that company screening the raw ingredients for heavy metals? At Beautycounter, we're screening raw materials for heavy metals, and we even do a post-production batch test on every single batch to make sure that, you know, the heavy metal is a very, very, you know, very low detect or no detect level, which I don't think many companies are doing, and it's really important.
Mm-hmm. We're going to take a couple-minute break, and when we come back, I want to talk about Beautycounter products and what some of the products are that you think are really superb and, you know, you want people to know about. Everyone, don't go anywhere. I'm talking with Donna Casali from the Beautycounter. Be right back.
Hi, I'm Gary Knoll. I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, are saddened by what we're seeing with people living in states that have been hit by some natural disaster. For example, the wildfires in California. It was just a year ago that the worst fires, three of them, in California history occurred. Now we're saying that these are now the new worst. 13,000 residents had to be evacuated out of Malibu. Thousands of homes destroyed, lives ruined. We also saw recently, in the last month, we saw a hurricane Category 4 just 2 miles an hour less than the Category 5 hit northern Florida and completely leveled an entire community. And then the new cycle changes. These are real people. These are not just statistics. And time after time we hear, we didn't think it would be this bad. We thought we could deal with it. We were left with nothing. No water, no food, no clothing. No personal items, nothing, everything destroyed. So what to do? This Sunday at noon, I'm going to address what do you do if there's a natural disaster? How can you prepare yourself so you don't lose everything, so you're out of harm's way? How can you prevent your house from being flooded or destroyed by fire? Where are the safest places to live, the best places to live, best quality of life in the United States, Canada, and around the world? I'm going to have a number of guests who are experts in their field talking about this Sunday in a special and unique webinar. We'll be taking your questions, addressing your concerns. So sign in, sign up, and join us for something that could save a life and protect your possessions. Sunday, noon. To get to the webinar, go to prn.fm. That's prn.fm. That's Progressive Radio Network. And that way you can see what we're going to do. I look forward to seeing you there, and we will have solutions. We will be able to solve problems. But we can't do it if we stay ignorant, if we engage in hubris, or think it'll never happen to us. Join us Sunday, noon, for a special webinar. What to do before disaster strikes. We'll see you then.
Bhavani at iEat Green on the Progressive Radio Network, and I'm here with my guest Donna Casali, Executive Director and Founding Member of Beautycounter. And we're just about to talk about some of the products that she recommends that Beautycounter makes that are superior to most of what else you can get out on the market. So Donna, what products do you think are really outstanding that you carry?
Yeah, my current obsession, and it's a relatively new product, it's called an overnight resurfacing peel. And basically what it is, it's a chemical peel without the chemicals. And no, it won't make your skin peel. What it is it's 15 botanical acids that I like to say it's almost like a magic eraser for signs of aging. So it reduces the appearance of pores. It will lighten any dark spots on your face. It will brighten, make your skin more supple, minimize fine lines. So, yeah, I notice, you know, I'm of a certain age now, and so my chest feels like it can be a little wrinkly. And since I've been using this every other night, I feel like all of those lines have kind of flattened out. So I don't usually wear a lot of makeup, but I've been wearing a lot less. I don't have any foundation on right now, and I feel like my skin is just so much brighter and more even. So I love that one. And that is our number one best-selling product right now.
Uh-huh. And what makes your products really stand out from other products? I mean, like I can go to Whole Foods and get, you know, some organic products there.
Right.
How do your products stand up to some of the natural products that I can find in Whole Foods?
That's a great question. Well, Bhavani, you know, the thing with Beautycounter is we're formulating to two pillars. So it's not just about making the product safer, but we're also formulating to performance. Performance is very, very important. And I think that our CEO, when she was creating this company, one of her big disappointments was that she would go into like a natural food store and try to buy things that were cleaner and better, and they weren't really giving her the performance she was looking for. And at the end of the day, we can't ask women to switch to safer products if they're not going to work well. And I think there's this misperception that maybe the safer products don't work as well, because to some extent it could be true. So, and we know this from looking for a safer deodorant, right, that works well.
I also, we were talking about this earlier, I have that with some of the safer cleaning products.
Yeah.
You know, I told you, I mean, even though I use really mostly good cleaning products, I do have some of the, you know,
yeah,
ones that are not so good in the back of my cabinet,
right,
in case I really have a, you know, a stain that I can't get off the counter, you know,
right,
and I'll pull out some soft scrub. And, you know, I don't use it as a regular thing, but it's a lifesaver when I have something on the counter that just won't come off with all the natural products I have.
You know, formulating products that are significantly safer but also high-performing is very tricky business. It's very, very difficult. I'll give you an example. It took 3 years to come out with a mascara, because it's almost like saying to someone, I need you to make me a chocolate cake, but you can't use eggs, milk, flour. You can't use, what are some of the other things in butter?
You know, chocolate.
I mean, you can make, you know this. You can make a chocolate cake.
I know, that's one of my favorite things, are those challenges that I get. Because
yeah,
I cook for people,
I mean,
with allergies.
You can do it. But
so, you know, it's like sometimes, you know, I was making a carrot cake with, you know, I could use carrots, but, you know, gluten-free, egg-free, but dairy was okay. They wanted the cream cheese frosting.
That's hilarious. And, you know, you and I both know that you can do it. You could totally do it. Is it difficult? It's very difficult. Is it going to taste like a traditional chocolate cake? Maybe not 100%. So the thing is, like something like mascara, those five main ingredients that you typically need to make mascara are highly, highly toxic. So to not use them and to look for alternatives, it really took 3 years to come out with a formula that was going to be both safe and also high performing. So, and I'm really proud to say that we actually earned an Allure Best in Beauty Award for our lengthening mascara when it debuted 2 years ago. So that's exciting.
Uh-huh. And I think I probably know the answer to this, but you don't use any plastics, like those plastic microbeads that so many products. I mean, I was shocked. You know, I used to use Clinique facial scrub. I loved it, you know.
Yeah.
And when I found out those little scrubbing things in there was not sand or salt or anything good, it was plastic beads, you know, the plastic beads that are polluting our oceans. I was completely upset.
Well, you know, when I first joined Beautycounter almost 5 years ago, that ban was not a nationwide ban. And even though it is a nationwide ban, those ingredients, you could still find them in toothpaste and other things, because we were talking about the eggs before we went on air about maybe you discussed it, how in 2020 they're going to have a square foot of roaming space.
Right.
Chickens. Well, this is what happens when the government finally decides to ban things. You know, it starts in the states, and so you've got states that are saying, okay, we're banning the microplastic beads, and then there's a nationwide ban. But the government still gives these companies 3 to 5 years to iron it out, to iron out the formulas, because, and I understand this, you know, it's a manufacturing process. It's not easy to really change a formula, and you have to really change the whole operation. But it's kind of sad that these microplastic beads have been banned for over a year now at least, and, you know, we're still going to see them in products. So that's why it's so important to know what to look for in a label and to, you know, to read those things. Triclosan is another thing that is still in some toothpaste. That was recently banned. That's the antibacterial ingredient that is now known to be a carcinogen, but it's still in toothpaste and hand soap.
What's it called again?
Triclosan. Triclosan or triclosan, T-R-I-C-L-O-S-A-N.
Uh-huh. You know, you've touched on antibiotic.
Antibacterial.
Yeah. That's in soaps all over the place.
Yeah.
And there's been a lot of talk about antibacterial soap as being one of the worst things for people's health because it's really breaking down their immune system making their immune system not able to fight the bacteria that they need to be able to fight. Are you familiar with antibacterial products at all?
That's the triclosan is that ingredient that I'm talking about, that it's killing the good bacteria as well as the bad bacteria. And I think there have been studies to show that antibacterial soap isn't necessarily better than just regular soap. It's actually, it's worse.
Yeah.
And this is why when they decided or they did more studies on this ingredient and they saw that it is, in fact, a human carcinogen, like, why are we using it? It's not necessarily more effective, so thank goodness they recently banned that as well.
So besides the facial peel, what are some of the other products that you would like? And the mascara. So,
yeah, the mascara is great. And I really like the face oils. And if you've never tried a face oil before, a pure plant-based face oil, and ours is a blend of 7 or 8 oils, think of it like vitamins for your skin because certain botanical oils have things like antioxidants and essential fatty acids. So they're kind of both like a treat and a product, but also a moisturizing product. So if you're like a real simple gal and you don't have this big routine where you want to use like a serum and then a moisturizer, I have a lot of clients that just wash their face and they just use this the face oils. And there are 3 different ones. There's one for brightening, which has vitamin C in it. There's one for plumping, which has jasmine. And jasmine oil, as the top note oil, promotes elasticity for mature skin. And the third one is the balancing oil, which has lang lang and chamomile. So if your skin is reactive or it's prone to redness or breaking out or it's, you know, combination or very, very oily or very, very dry, the face oil is going to bring your skin into balance. And I want to just say, because a lot of people, it's very counterintuitive. So if you're oily...
Right, people think you're going to break out. You put oil on your skin, it's going to make you break out.
Well, when you're using a pure plant-based oil, you know, it really does absorb into your skin, and it kind of signals your skin to stop producing so much oil, because we can get into this cycle of over-drying our skin, and then our skin, in response, produces more oil, and then we can't get out of that. But by using these botanical oils, the blends of the oils, it really does bring skin into balance. So if you have never tried a face oil, our face oils are amazing.
Mm-hmm. And what personal care products are the most toxic that people use on a regular basis?
Good. I'm glad
do you have
asking.
Ones that
yeah.
you that are really like red lights that people should really
100%.
Okay.
So deodorant would be one. You know,
well, aluminum.
Really,
of course.
Really, it's the antiperspirant, so the aluminum. But you know, deodorant. You know, again, fragrance first thing you want out of the product. Parabens is the second thing to look for on a label because that's a very commonly used preservative that is a hormone disruptor. So deodorant is one. Nail polish. There's something called the toxic trio, which is formaldehyde, dibutyl phthalate, and toluene. And so if you go into any nail salon where you live, typically the base coat they use has formaldehyde in it. So I always tell people, bring your own base coat. Make sure it's a brand that's like 5-free or 7-free. And by the way, I have all this information I have a group on Facebook called Clean Beauty and Wellness. And because we don't make nail polish and we don't make deodorant, but I still like to educate and help people make better, safer choices with toothpaste, for example.
Right.
But so it's the nail polish, it's the deodorant, it's the sunscreen, you talked about that. That's another big one. I think about, according to the EWG, which is the Environmental Working Group, I think 75% of the sunscreens on the market are chemical sunscreens, and as such, they contain ingredients that can mess with your hormones versus using a mineral sunscreen, which is what we do at Beautycounter. Mm-hmm. I think our sunscreen is amazing because typically when you're using zinc oxide or titanium dioxide, which is a mineral sunscreen agent, it can make your skin look white, and no one wants to look like Casper the Friendly.
I was just going to say that because my kids hate it.
Yeah.
You know, that's the one that I buy, and that's what I have here at the house, and they'll still go out and buy some of the other stuff that I tell them not to buy, of course.
Well, the thing is, it's really about working with a micro particle of the titanium and the zinc to formulate it in such a way that when you rub it in, you know, it does rub in clear. And I'm very excited that we just came out with a non-aerosol spray. It's not a pump spray. It feels like an aerosol, but it's like this airless, I don't know the technology to explain it, but it sprays like an aerosol but doesn't have any of the nasty propellants in it. Because the spray sunscreens are the worst because you're inhaling all those particles when they truly are using those toxic propellants. So sunscreen is one. Of course, hair dye, and you and I are sitting here across from each other right now with our beautiful silver hair.
Uh-huh.
I stopped almost like a year and a half ago.
Same with me, right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
So that's really toxic, the hair dye. And I'm trying to think about mascara.
And what about the natural hair dye that I was buying from Whole Foods?
Yeah.
That I was assuming that was better.
You know what? I was on a quest to find a safer hair dye, and I found a brand ultimately that I thought was relatively safer. But at the end of the day, there are certain things that are needed in the formula to color the hair that are just inherently toxic. And even something like henna, you know, it's when you're talking about things that come out of the earth and, you know, the colorants that come from the soil, are those products being screened for heavy metals? Because if they're not, you don't know what you're getting in that. So that's the thing about natural doesn't necessarily mean that it's safer, you know, unless it's being screened for impurities. And because nobody's putting lead in your lipstick, right? You hear about this all the time. Oh, is there lead in your lipstick? It's not an ingredient. It's a contamination byproduct of the manufacturing process.
Right.
So I would say lipstick is another one, you know, any color cosmetic, because it could have the heavy metals.
And even, you know, when you talk about nail polish, it can be absorbed through your nail. I always think of the nail as being, you know, hard and like that, you know, it wouldn't absorb the same way skin would.
Well, you know, I'm not really a scientist. So I can't really answer that. But you are breathing it all in when you're sitting there for the manicure.
Sure. Yeah, just walk into a nail salon, you know that's toxic.
And, you know, I mean, sometimes we eat with our hands and our fingers go in our mouths, or we have children and they're, you know, loving on us. And that's why, you know, if you're a young mother, you know, remember when the kids were little and they would give you all these wet, sloppy kisses? Like, you want to make sure that what you're putting on your skin is safe. It's not toxic.
Sure. So can you buy Beautycounter products in stores, or do you have to know someone who's selling them? How does that work?
So Beautycounter is a direct retail brand. And what that means is we have an e-commerce website. You can go directly to the website. You don't have to work with a consultant, although it's always nice to work with one because they can help you decide what to try. We had summer pop-up shops in Nantucket and out in East Hampton, and we're opening up a small storefront in Soho in New York City, which is super exciting. And the really cool thing about that is everybody says to me, oh, you know, is that good for you, Donna? Because, you know, I have clients that shop with me, and my clients live everywhere in the United States. You know, they're not necessarily local to me. But if anyone, like, say, Bhavani, you want to go into the Soho shop and check it out, and if you want to pick up some Beautycounter products, you just mention my name, and I will get full commission on that order, so that's so exciting. So it's really not, you know, it's not hurting us as consultants. It's a very kind of the rising tide lifts all boats. So we're looking for multiple channels to get the products into people's hands. We want to meet people where they want to shop. So if someone wants to go online, they want to work with a consultant, if they want to walk into a storefront, you know, we're not a retail model. We're not going to have storefronts all over the place. The reason our CEO did that was, and she was in fashion and retail, by the way, so she had all of the connections to get these products in stores. But the story of safe ingredients is best told person to person. And so this is why she made this a direct retail model where, someone could join the company as a consultant. They could represent the products, and they could share them with their friends and family and make a really nice income doing so. So I appreciate that she decided to do it that way.
Uh-huh. So it's kind of like an Avon thing, right? Or
it's a super cool Avon in a sense. It's similar to that model where it's direct sales, and but it's really different. You know, we don't have to stock products. I don't know if Avon does or not, but the point is that it's just, we're a company with a mission. We're so much more than a beauty company. We're really a mission and a movement that is hoping to disrupt the industry and move it in the right direction. And I think right now we're pretty much the leaders in this space as far as like a big company goes. So I'm very proud to be a part of that.
I remember reading about like Gwyneth Paltrow was coming out with a whole line of products, mm-hmm. and are her products also considered natural?
Yeah, I think she has, it's interesting, our CEO is friends with her, and she, several years ago, they went into the Goop offices and kind of was looking at all their cleaning products and helped her switch to safer products of that. And this is before Goop came out with their personal care products. But at the time,
Goop, I didn't remember what it's called.
Yeah, Goop actually has some Beautycounter products on their website. They definitely promote us, you know, as a good clean brand. But yeah, she has since come out with her own stuff, and I'm assuming it's good. Like, we're very happy to see other companies want to do better with their ingredients. You know, we don't look at it as a competition. It's, you know, we share information with other companies, you know, in terms of what we are discovering in terms of ingredient toxicity, and we want the industry to move in the right direction, and it's a big enough industry that for everyone to be successful. So it's, you know, we never bash other brands or put down other
brands. Yeah, I love hearing that because, you know, collaboration and cooperation are models that we really need to promote going forward. The competition model of capitalism, it just does not,
no,
is not sustainable. It's not good for people. It's not good for the planet. We really need to move towards a more holistic, collaborative, cooperative movement so we can all be on the same mission, you know, working towards a cleaner planet, because that's ultimately what we want. We want, you know, everyone to be healthier. We want the planet to do better, and we want to get rid of the corporate greed that is behind the, you know, big corporations that are making millions at the expense of our health.
100%. And there's strength in numbers. Like, our CEO reached out to other clean beauty brands and the owners and founders, and they all got together and they went to Washington about a year and a half ago to meet with representatives from the Senate and the House to talk about, you know, wanting more regulation, needing more oversight, because people think the FDA can recall a product off of the shelves, and they really, really can't.
I was reading about that. I wrote about it one time. Yeah, there's very little power that we have when it comes to personal care products. But what can people do who are listening to this show? Mm-hmm. How can they let their representatives know that they do care about safer beauty products? Is there a movement? Is there a petition?
Yeah,
is there
definitely
what
is.
Can we do?
You know what? I'm sorry that I don't have it with me, but I'm going to give it to you to post next week in the program notes.
Okay.
But they can text Better Beauty to, like, a number, and that will loop them into sending a letter to their local representatives. And, you know, never doubt the power of your voice. You know, it's...
I tell people that all the time.
Yeah. If a representative gets 20 phone calls on an issue, they have to address it. It's really interesting. I've learned a lot about this because I've been to Washington twice in the last 3 or 4 years to meet with members of you know, Congress, and it's been really an interesting experience.
Mm-hmm. Good. Well, definitely share that with me, because you know, as you know, I will be posting the link to this podcast up on my website and in my blog next week. And I'll share that information along with your website and all that information. But why don't you let my listeners know how they find Beautycounter or you? Or
sure. There's something called the Never List that is on my website, and those are the most common ingredients linked to cancer and hormone disruption. So I definitely want you to navigate to that. But my website is beautycounter.com/Donna Casali. and Casali is spelled C-A-S as in Sam, A-L-I. And you can connect with me through the website, send me a message if you want more information. But basically, we need more voices. So there are four ways you can get involved with Beautycounter. You can shop as a client, and if you want to try the products, you have 60 days to enjoy them. And if you're not happy with anything, you can send them back with a free shipping label. We have a membership rewards program. You can host a gathering to educate other people about Beautycounter, where I would come if you're local to me, and or we could do it virtually, or you could join us as a consultant. We really, really do need more voices. We need more people out there educating people about the ingredients to avoid, how to read a label, and to really limit the exposure to toxins.
Great. Thank you. So, everyone, we're just about out of time, so I want to thank you all for joining us, and I've been talking with Donna Casali from the Beautycounter, and I will see you all again next week. If you are in the New York area and you have coats to donate, please drop them off at the IE Green Homestead, and please come on down and cook with us. Love to see you. Have a great week, and I'll see you all again, not next week, it's Thanksgiving, but the week after. Bye for now.